Thomas, Percy and Toby listened anxiously as the summer gale rattled the windows and moaned in the roof of the engine shed. Gradually, the moan rose to a howl. There was a crack and a slithering noise on the roof as a slate broke and slid into the guttering. The engine shivered. When their crews came to start work the next morning, the engines had had very little sleep.
There's a mountain railway I've heard of, said Thomas hopefully, where the train stops running if it's too windy, because it's too dangerous.
His driver laughed. Sorry, Thomas, he said. To begin with, you're weighing much more than those little engines, and secondly, wind is usually far worse up in the mountains. Thomas soon found out that the wind was not only strong, but cold too. Annie and Clarabel didn't like it any more than he did, but grumbled not because of the wind, but because there aren't many passengers. Thomas didn't blame the passengers for staying at home. He wished he could have done the same. Yet, as they passed the cricket field near the station by the river, Thomas was amazed to see white-clad figures playing.
It's an important match, exclaimed his fireman,
who played cricket himself when he had the time.
The final of the soda and knockout competition. But I don't envy them in this wind.
Trees between the railway and cricket field swelled wildly in the wind as Thomas ran past. One of the players recognised the fireman and waved. The fireman waved back, but he was glad to be in the shelter of Thomas's cab today. At the junction, James told them about the trouble that the wind had caused all over the island.
Let's get home as quickly as we can, said Thomas when James had gone.
They reached the middle station safely and stopped. Only two passengers got out, and Thomas whistled and set off again. By the time they reached the curve, which led around the cricket field, they were running nicely.
Come along now, come along now,
he puffed confidently to Annie and Clarabel.
Not far now, he said to himself. We'll soon be back in our warm shed.
He was halfway round the bend when a flash of white caught his eye. Almost at once, the train's brakes came on as a guard pulled the emergency cord. With a squeal, Thomas slowed and stopped, but not before he had rounded the curve far enough to see a huge tree lying across the line.
Oh, phew! He exclaimed. How did the guard know about that?
His driver looked back and saw some cricketers running towards them, followed by the guard.
Thank goodness, panted the cricketers. We heard Thomas's whistle as he left the station. And just then, we saw the tree come down. We didn't think we'd be in time. We're glad we were. So are we, remarked the fireman. Thank you.
And since Thomas could go no further until the tree was cleared, the driver and fireman took him back to the middle station. Then, Bertie took the passengers home. They watched the rest of the cricket match, which the local team won after a close and exciting finish. A few days later, at a meeting in the cricket pavilion, the fat controller presented the cricketers with a framed certificate to remind them of the day they saved the train. The cricketers were almost prouder of this than their cricket trophy.
Next year, said the captain of the team, we may have to pass the cricket cup to someone else, but your certificate will always be here.